Thank you, Jerry. Thank you all for coming. It's wonderful to be here, and it's a great thrill and privilege for me to introduce Jay Parini to you this afternoon. Averaging almost a book a year since the early 90s, I wonder when Jay sleeps, eats, teaches, lives outside of writing. I wonder also how he's managed to cross the hedgehog, who, as the philosopher Isaiah Berlin famously claimed, knows one thing very well, with the fox, who knows many, many things, into one brilliant writer who knows a lot of things very well. A quick look at the list of Jay's books reveals his range and genius as artist and scholar, and actually the list is too long for me to read, without taking up a long time, so I'll just mention a few. Theodore Retke, an American Romantic, The Patch Boys, Anthracite Country, Vermont Christmas, Town Life, a novel of Tolstoy's last year, Bay of Arrows, John Steinbeck, a biography, Benjamin's Crossing, which is now being made into a film, and Jay will be in Romania this spring on site to oversee that, as he was with The Last Station, a wonderful movie that came out about Tolstoy's last year. Some Necessary Angels, Essays in Literature and Politics, The Apprentice Lover, Passage to Liberty, The Story of Italian Immigration, Anthony Quinn's I, Why Poetry Matters, Promised Land, 13 Books That Changed America, The Passages of H.M., and I'm leaving out a lot of wonderful biographies, the one you probably heard about this morning, the one on Frost, which is really a magnificent definitive work on that great poet. And he grades papers, too. He's a professor at Middlebury, where he grades a lot of papers, and he once told me that he has a secret on how to grade them quickly, which he won't tell me. Jay's academic career has been as illustrious as his writing career. He's the D.E. Axinn Professor of English and Creative Writing at Middlebury College. In 1976, he co-founded the New England Review with Sidney Lee. He's a member of the Board of Visitors of Ralston College, a liberal arts college in Savannah that was founded in 2010. In 1993, he was awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship. The same year, he became the Fowler Hamilton Fellow at Christ Church in Oxford. From 2005 to 2006, he was a fellow at the Institute for Advanced Studies at the University of London. No matter what genre Jay writes in, he executes a style that is probative, lapidary, lucid, lyrical, and deeply intelligent. With one eye on the craft of writing and the other on his myriad human subjects, Jay joins these two visions, as Robert Frost wrote at the end of Two Tramps in Mud Time, to make one insight. He's a born writer and thinker for whom language appears to come so easily. In all his writing, belying the near impossible work that lies beneath and behind his prodigious output. In his new book, Jesus, Jay turns exegesis into engaging, enlightened prose, taking on questions of faith, critical and doctrinal controversies, and the same biographical conundrum that has mystified Christians and agnostics alike for centuries, millennia. Who was Jesus? While he doesn't presume to answer this question in any definitive historical way, he has found a way, nonetheless, to write his own biography about Jesus that is generous, timely, sensible, and authoritative, and in a language that clearly enlightens Jay himself, as it appears before him on the page. Jay Parini.
Thank you, Chard. Lovely to be here. And such a lovely introduction. I really deeply appreciate the work that goes into presenting an introduction like that. Chard is a very old friend, so I'm extra glad that he's doing that. So we've got, maybe 40 minutes or so, 45 minutes to talk about Jesus. It does seem like an unlikely thing from today, from Robert Frost to Jesus. And in fact, I've just finished my major new biography of Gore Vidal, which will appear next fall. And I was just, in fact, at a literary festival somewhere else, and someone stood up at the end and said, "Mr. Parini, I don't understand it. How would you've gone from a life of Jesus Christ to a life of Gore Vidal? How would you compare and contrast these figures?" And I thought, and I said, "Well, put it this way. Jesus didn't think he was Gore Vidal." So I'll be using that for... That just came to me when I was doing that, and I'm not going to be using that joke for a while. Not bad. Although oddly enough, they have nothing in common. So people keep asking me, how on earth did you come to write a book about the life of Christ, Jesus? And that essentially, the story of this book is kind of interesting. I had been planning to write a novel about Jesus. I've done historical novels based on real figures. You know, I did Tolstoy, Walter Benjamin, Herman Melville novels. They're fictions. And I had been wanting to do, I thought, wow, wouldn't it be great to do a novel about the life of Jesus and telling it from, say, many viewpoints. You know, obviously maybe Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, maybe Mary, maybe Mary Magdalene, and so forth. What endless opportunities for a kind of a kaleidoscopic vision of Jesus. And I was doing research on it for some years because I am myself, first of all, a genuine Christian. I've gone to church for my whole life, but certainly the last 40 years I've been involved in the Anglican Church in England and again, Episcopal Church in the USA. I've gone to church, you know, every Sunday for all these years, sat on the vestry and so forth. When I was in graduate school in Scotland for 7 years I was there, at one point I thought I might become a minister, so I studied in St. Mary's Divinity School there for a while and learned. You know, I'd been doing classical Greek, and I switched over to doing, you know, Koine Greek, which the New Testament is written in, which is really just very simple Greek. And and I kept up with theological reading all these years, and my own religious practice. So I had some basis for doing this. But I wanted to do it as a novel, and I was in New York visiting someone. I had lunch with a friend who said, "Listen, Jay, I've just taken over this series for Houghton Mifflin called Icons. We're going to do 10 biographies of world figures. And I'd love you to do one of them." I said, "Okay." He said, "What do you want to do?" I said, "How about Jesus?" He said, "Jesus?" "Yes, Jesus." He said, "Jesus Christ." So I said, "Yes, Jesus Christ. He's the one." So I thought I must need my head examined as I was driving home, because it's one thing to write a novel and make it up, sort of. But I realized if you're going to do a book like this one, Jesus, the Human Face of God, it's, you know, you go to the library and there's not just a shelf of books on Jesus, but there's rooms full of books on Jesus, and there's a vast tradition of scholarship on Jesus that you have to kind of at least make some attempt to come to grips with. And so I knew I was in for an awful lot of work, but it was pleasurable work and interesting work to me in a tremendous way. I thought, you know, for a long time people thought you really could, theologians in the 30s, for example, thought that you really couldn't even write a life of Jesus, that there was so little biographical evidence. And I do call, in early on in my book, say that this is about the mythos of Jesus. The mythos is just the Greek word for story. And I say, this is one of the great stories of all time. And I'm really, frankly, uninterested in what is literally true or not literally true. I'm interested in the mythic potential of this story and how it has been transformative in human lives and civilizations over many centuries, two millennia. So, I take it for granted that I'm the most liberal kind of Christian who really is interested in mythos and interested in myth. Back in the 60s, I'd been devoted to Joseph Campbell and that kind of thing. I was interested in the mythic journey, and Jesus is the ultimate mythic journey. And I thought, well, this is actually a good time to be writing about the life of Jesus for various reasons. First of all, there have been so much new material has become available in the second half of the 20th century. You had all the discoveries at Nag Hammadi of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which when they had been translated and opened up, huge. I mean, if you know about the Gnostic Gospels, Elaine Pagels has a great book on this, but there's lots of books. The Gnostic Gospels were, you know, over 20 Gospels that were written. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were only the four obvious ones at the church. Early on, people decided, let's stick with these guys and forget about the Gospel of Thomas, the Gospel of Philip, the Gospel of Mary, blah, 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 blah. But they're fascinating to read, and they fill in many aspects of the life of Jesus. That was just a miraculous accidental discovery by two shepherds in Egypt in 1946 or 7. They hit this clay pot, and they opened it up, and there were all these Gospels, which had been missing for 2,000 years. So extraordinary new information there. Then, of course, you had the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which revealed immense amounts of new material, basically from the group called the Essenes, the Essenic scriptures. Writings, which Jesus obviously was getting, if he might have been an Essene himself, but he certainly got a tremendous amount of influence from this. So you have all of that new information coming from the Gnostic Gospels and the Dead Sea Scrolls, which are uncovered in Qumran between, say, 1947, 8 up through 1954. They kept discovering new material. It's a vast trove, amazing. And then you start getting all these archaeological discoveries. Archaeologists in the Middle East started doing an immense amount of research and into what's called Second Temple Judaism. First Temple being Solomon's Temple, which got destroyed by the Babylonians. The Jews go into exile. That's like, you know, 6th century BC, 586 or something. And then there's hundreds of years, and then King Herod builds the great new temple, right? King Herod's temple, which is there when Jesus is a kid, and it's the center of life, religious life in Palestine in what the period was called Second Temple Judaism. That's destroyed in 70 AD, okay? Right around the time the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, were written, or at least Matthew, Mark, Luke a little bit later, John probably 30 years later. But in any case, you've got that period there, Second Temple Judaism. Immense amounts of new archaeological research opened up what was possible. And we know much more, a lot of great books about Jesus as a Jew. And so we can place Jesus in the real context of the kinds of Judaism that were really prevalent in his time. And Jesus was, in my book, certainly it's important that he's a Jew, and that he never really thinks of himself as founding a new religion. There was no Christianity that he was trying to found. Even in the whole Bible, no one talks about being a Christian, really. It's not a concept. Even Paul, the great apostle, and much of what we know as Christianity is really the work of Paul, right? The earliest Christian scriptures that we have are the letters of Paul, with, say, 2 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, maybe being written 20-30 AD, right? This is the earliest material. So the authentic seven letters of Paul, there are 13 of them, but the other ones are school of Paul. But those core letters of Paul's, you know, Corinthians, Romans, Galatians, and so forth, are 20, 30, 40, 50 AD. Those are the earliest Christian writings. And then you get the Gospel of Mark being the first gospel to come along, maybe 50. Or 60 AD, and then you get other synoptic gospels. Synopsis just means seeing together. They're very much operating out of the same material. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are very similar. John coming late. So you also then, therefore, we're getting an immense amount of new scholarship on the textual tradition of the Bible. I mean, this had been going on from the mid-19th century, by the way, or even the late 18th century German scholars were comparing and contrasting the Gospels and saying, what's going on here? They notice, for example, the Christmas story only appears in Matthew and Luke. And it's a very different story in Matthew and Luke. They don't even reconcile, not even remotely. In Matthew, it's a story. It's a story of flight and terror. Jesus is, you know, born into this jeopardized situation. King Herod's killing, the massacre of the innocents, killing every baby born under the age of two or around it, or under the age of two. Jesus is born and quickly whisked away through the desert to Egypt, where he hides out until it's safe to come back to Nazareth. Well, that's the story of Christmas story in Matthew. Very different story in Luke. It's you know, angels keeping watch over the flocks by night. It's a very bucolic scene, star hovering and so forth. And Jesus goes to the temple in Jerusalem to circumcise, as every Jew would, on the eighth day, blah, blah, blah. The story of, you know, lots of other things going on there. But the stories don't match or reconcile in the remotest. They're probably, in fact, late additions to these two Gospels, probably coming in from Persia, because you did need a story of origins. So it's interesting to see this kind of palimpsest that each Gospel is, with text overwriting text overwriting texts. And you can, you know, it's the first version of Mark that we have, in fact, doesn't include the resurrection of Jesus. It ends with his death. So much later added, the resurrection. So I had long been interested in all of the textual tradition of the Gospels. I had been studying the Gnostic Gospels for some years and reading material on the Dead Sea Scrolls and theological, you know, dispositions, reflections on the Jesus story. So when I sat down to write this book, I simply, the first thing I did was reread the four main Gospels and some of the Gnostic Gospels. Really going, and in fact, in the book itself, every time I quote the Gospels, it's my own translation from the Greek. And except in the Sermon on the Mount, where I thought, you know, I kept trying to match it, but I thought, no, I can't match the King James, it's too beautiful. You know, I thought, I'm not going to try to do the Beatitudes in my own poetic language. It's just not going to work. Whenever I quote the Old Testament, I always quote the King James Version, because that's what God sounds like to me. It should be in the King James Version. So, and I don't speak any Hebrew, just I've studied a little bit of Hebrew, not enough to do any translation remotely. So, for me it was a question of simply, I begin with the situation. What was Palestine like at the time of Jesus? Who were the different groups, and strands of Judaism that were prevalent at the time? You know, people like the Pharisees and so forth, and the Essenes, and the Zealots, and so forth and so on. So I give a kind of outline of the various movements that were afoot. I note that Jesus was born on the Silk Road. That's so fast. I suddenly realized that, and I read something about that, and said, wait a minute, so this is how he's doing it. He's a religious genius born on the Silk Road, who is getting from the West, from Greece, all of these ideas about body and soul, Platonic notions, coming in, swimming into him. From the East, all these merchants from Persia are bringing with them Hinduism and Buddhism, ideas of karma. And I think my favorite part of my own book in Jesus is the reading of the Sermon on the Mount, which I think is essentially a reincarnation of karma as a notion. Right, and blessed are the merciful, for God shall show them mercy, that idea. Over and over again, the Sermon on the Mount, certainly the Beatitudes, are I think, Christian versions of karma, the idea of karma. As you sow, ye shall reap. So that's why, and also it will carry on from generation to generation. The Sermon on the Mount is really the core teachings of Jesus. Matthew, the book of Matthew, was essentially a textbook used by the earliest Christians as to train possible clergy in Antioch. And so it's very neatly organized. The Sermon on the Mount is an amazing, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. If you ever never read anything else in the Bible, just read Matthew 5, 6, and 7. And you get the great Beatitudes, you get the antitheses, which I think are the core of the Christian teachings, where he takes the old teachings. In the old days, they said an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. I say, if someone strikes you, turn the other cheek, right? So it's on the one hand this, on the other, but they used to say that, now I'm saying this. Jesus is really overturning Judaism. I think he's, to some degree, modifying and extending, but it's really a transformation of the old Judaic system. And it's quite profound in my view. I mean, the Beatitudes and the antitheses are amazing. And then you get some of the great teachings. You get, you know, the Golden Rule, which, you know, it was around for a long time, goes back to Sumerian times. You get some of the great parables are put in there. But it's an amazingly refreshing, finally with, you know, that marvelous, exhilarating passage about, you know, consider the lilies of the field, right? They neither toil nor spin. Don't worry about tomorrow. Worry about now, right? Eat. And so I had a nice time talking about Jesus wandering with his disciples and all these women wandering with him, Mary Magdalene, lots of women were with him always. He was a real hippie, wandering with women and men, and they were sleeping in the fields. Jesus is often partying. He's often having a lot of drinks. There's celebrations everywhere. I always remind people that at the Last Supper, that everybody in the room had to have 4 cups of wine. So by the time they got to the Garden of Gethsemane, they were feeling no pain, right? Like it was a Seder, right? According to Jewish law, you're supposed to have 4 glasses of wine at the Seder. So that's what's going on there. And so it's amazing how much obvious stuff there is that when you put it together, people go, what? You know, when you start looking at the stories of Jesus and the teachings, and put it in the context of Second Temple Judaism, bringing in all the new information, and just reading the Gospels closely, you start getting a very different idea of who this guy was and what he was about. I tend to think that Jesus, slowly began discovering that he had special contact with the Spirit, with God. And gradually, only very gradually, does he begin to see his role as a sacrificial lamb. I don't think that's the main thing. I enjoyed writing my passage on writing about the resurrection. Easter Sunday was very complicated. I rewrote that page about 25, 35 times because I wanted to get it, I was trying to discover what I really thought about this business. I had to say to myself, what do I really think that the crucifixion of Jesus and the resurrection are about? And I came to the conclusion that the resurrection was not the great resuscitation. Jesus suddenly, I'm alive, hello guys. How do we know this? Well, look at the stories in the Bible as they're told in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. Jesus, the first person to meet Jesus is Mary Magdalene, right? She comes into the tomb on Easter morning, and this guy sitting there, she doesn't know who it is. She doesn't know, she has no idea who this is. She thinks it's the gardener. And she's been Jesus' closest friend, Mary Magdalene. And finally he says, Mary. She goes, Rabboni, speaking in Aramaic. She finally gets who he is. But then she panics and flees and goes gets Peter. Everybody's panicked. Take the story of the road to Emmaus. That's an astonishing story. I retell it in the book. Jesus, some of his disciples are on their way out of Jerusalem, walking to Emmaus on the dirt road, and this figure appears beside them. And he says, so what are you guys talking about? They say, what, you haven't heard about Jesus? He was our great master, our teacher, our rabbi, and he was crucified. It's so awful. He said, oh, really? Huh, that's terrible. I didn't know about that. They walk all day. They get to near outside of Emmaus. They sit down for dinner. And they said, will you join us? Jesus says, sure, I'd love to join you. Jesus says, do you mind if I offer a word of prayer? And he does his famous prayer. They go, are you Jesus? Jesus goes, disappears, poof, invisible. Endless stories like this. Take him, the fisherman, after Jesus is crucified, and some of the disciples who are fishermen, Andrew, John, and so forth, Peter, are upset, and they go back to Galilee, and they start fishing again. They say, well, we have to take up a job. Can't live by bread alone, whatever. And they're fishing, but they're getting nowhere. And suddenly, no fish. And suddenly, this figure on the shore says, try the other side of the boat. And they go, what? So Peter says, listen to him, try the other side of the boat. Suddenly, they catch fish. So they bring them in. They're thrilled. And it's quite a while before suddenly the beloved apostle, probably John, turns to Peter and says, hey, isn't that? Peter goes, it's Jesus! This is the kind of thing. No, the point is, over and over and over again, the Gospels tell us that when people see Jesus post-resurrection, they don't know who he is, right? I think it's a message saying, this is not, as I said, the great resuscitation. It's a transformation. And I think this is what resurrection is. It's a personal transformation. I always like to say that, and this paradigm of crucifixion, Easter, Good Friday, Holy Saturday, this terrible dark tunnel between the crucifixion and Easter, and then Easter morning, resurrection, is a sequence that, I go through it about 6 times a day. And I think it's part of our lives. Yeah? And I think again and again the teachings of Jesus are essentially very Buddhist. You know, essentially I think he's teaching that eternity is now. It's with us now. I mean, T.S. Eliot's Four Quartets, you know, talks about the still point of the turning world. It's an astonishing sequence of poetry, which I think gets Christianity exactly right. And combining with it, you know, Eastern ideas with Western ideas, and Eliot always. So for me, it was an exhilarating book. I ended with a chapter called The Afterlife of Jesus, in which I talk about all of the attempts over centuries to come to terms with the life of Jesus, and the fact the historical Jesus, was it possible, is it not possible? Going back to Hermann Remarus, the great German scholar, who came up with the idea that Jesus was probably a zealot who was killed because he belonged to the zealot group and was a danger to Rome. That was recently revived by a guy in a book who simply copied that idea. And that's been a strain all the way along. I think it's foolish if you look at the actual teachings of Jesus, though, who was actually, I think, a very strong teacher of a nonviolent resistance to violence, right? I think he was endlessly preaching, turn the other cheek. If someone strikes you, if someone asks for your sweater, give them your coat as well. I mean, Jesus was always preaching peace, and I think that is... So I think the zealotry thing is out of keeping, although Jesus certainly had zealots around him. I do some things too, like for instance, you take the story, I love the story of Barabbas, or you know that story. Pontius Pilate says, you know, I see nothing wrong with this guy. Once a year we get to release a prisoner, why don't you release Barabbas? Barabbas was kind of a revolutionary, I think he was a zealot. And they say, no, release Jesus. And they say, no, let's release Barabbas. Give us Barabbas. He says, no, come on, have Jesus. Don't take Barabbas. Give us Barabbas. Well, you start doing a little etymological research. Barabbas' first name was Jesus. So Jesus Barabbas versus Jesus. His last name wasn't Christ, by the way. We don't know what his last name was. But in fact, what does Barabbas mean? In Aramaic, it means son of God. So they're saying, Pilate is really saying, and early readers of the Greek Gospels got the joke. Would you like Jesus, the Son of God, or Jesus Christ, the Messiah? In other words, what's the choice here? It's incredibly interesting to start looking at the book philologically. I do a lot of philological discussions in my book, looking at the Greek words. Like, for instance, one of the key things, my father was a Baptist preacher. And, you know, he used to always say, well, repent and you shall be saved. But you start looking at those words in the Greek, and the Greek, it doesn't translate that way. The Greek word for, repent comes from a Latin, mistranslation of the Greek word metanoia. I mean, a lot of the problems with Christianity, as far as I'm concerned, come from St. Jerome's 4th century Latin translation of the Greek Bible. Always working from the Greek Bible, probably never the Hebrew, because that's how we get the idea of the Virgin Mary. That's simply a mistranslation of the word Alma, which means young woman, which becomes Parthenos in Greek, which means virgin. So that was just a... And then when it gets into the Latin, you've got Jesus, Mary, really a virgin. So things like that, the transmogrifications of words through translation and mistranslation. But going back to the original thing, repent and you shall be saved. Really, I would retranslate that sentence, that line of scripture, and I do. Open yourself up to the wider mind of the Spirit. You will experience enlightenment. To go beyond your own mind, the word is metanoia. Meta, as in metaphysics, going beyond physics, right? Noia, just in Greek, means mind. So opening up your mind to the wider mind of God and experience enlightenment, satoria in Greek. So different from, oddly enough, the word satori, interesting. So it's an interesting, although they are not cognates, but just an interesting coincidence. So I do a lot of working with the language. And I'm very interested in how language operates in the life of Jesus. And I think it's very informative. I mean, remember, Jesus was an Aramaic speaker, right? When he goes into, in his first time in the synagogue, when he speaks to his friends in the ecclesia, which is just a gathering. We use the word church to translate ecclesia, which is a gathering, as in synagogos is just a gathering, right? Two words for gathering. Jesus reads from the book of Isaiah. Well, he's reading it in pericopes. Pericopes were all you would have had in those days. Little bits, pieces from the stories from the scriptures, right? No one had a whole scroll of, say, Isaiah or any of the prophets or so forth. You had little bits and pieces. Pericope, to cut around, take out a little slice, right? Peri, going around, cope, cut, take a little chunk. That's a pericope. And so Jesus would have known the Bible probably in Aramaic Targumim, which just means translations of the Hebrew Bible scriptures, right? So it's just fascinating. What's one of the things I do in the book is, to some degree, try to give some sense of the historical transmissions of knowledge and text, some of the linguistic transformations, and try to analyze some of the spiritual dimensions of Jesus' teaching, and then the wider meaning of his life, right? So the mythos, tracing the story of the mythic dimensions of the life of Jesus. So that's what I tried to do, and so far it's been very interesting to hear the responses of people to this. You know, I've tried to keep going with this in the sense that I've been writing once a month for CNN or the Daily Beast or something, or Huffington Post, mostly for CNN, pieces on reflections on aspects of Christianity. I did one this weekend, and I always know when I'm going to be, or I did one last Easter. Easter Sunday, I woke up and I said to my wife, oh, look at this, the first two emails today. The first one says, Dear Satan. The next one says, Dear Santa. But you know, I had 500 emails yesterday because I had a piece on CNN. Literally 500 emails yesterday because I did a piece on CNN saying, interesting that so many of the mainstream churches are beginning to open themselves up to gay marriage. I said, even the Pope, Pope Francis, I said, in 1913, said probably the five most important words of 2013 when on the plane back from Brazil. He said, he was asked about gays in the church, Catholic Church. He said, who am I to judge? Which is what Christ would have said, judge not lest ye be judged. I know that the Presbyterian Church has this year, finally this summer, voted to allow gay marriage. I say the Episcopal Church, to which I belong to, has long allowed gay priests, gay marriage. I noted that last week Jimmy Carter was speaking at a college in Michigan, and he was asked what his feelings were on gay marriage. He said, it's fine with me. I'm a Baptist, but I think every congregation in a Baptist church has to choose for themselves, but it's okay with me. So I said, wow, we're seeing a kind of a seismic shift here. And I said, well, what did Jesus really teach on the issue of gays? I said, of course, St. Paul was vexed on this matter. St. Paul was an old Pharisee trained, he was a Pharisee, and he was a deeply Orthodox Jew. And so he would have been strongly influenced by Leviticus. And so that's where all the nasty stuff about it being sinful to be gay is coming out of Leviticus, and then getting refracted in complex ways in three or four instances in Paul. Jesus himself never really talks about this, right? Jesus never mentions, nobody would have thought about it in those days, frankly. But the one interesting passage I point to, and I don't know if I'm right or wrong on this, but I went back to the passage, Jesus has his famous teaching about, you know, a man shall leave his mother and a woman shall leave her parents and they'll be joined together, and let what God has put together, let no man put asunder. Hence I tell you, no divorce is allowed. But then the disciples say, well, that's kind of complicated, Jesus. Can we talk about that a little more? And Jesus says, well, he said, this is a complicated teaching, obviously. And to some people, these teachings will be understandable. To others, not. And he goes on, kind of hedging his bet a little bit. And he said, you know, and then he goes on to this incredible disquisition about eunuchs, saying, you know, some people are born eunuchs. And that's just the way it is. Other people have, you know, being eunuchs thrust upon them, choose to be eunuchs and so forth. And I know they must have been scratching their heads at this. And I went back to I got out my Greek Bible and I looked at the words eunuchos. And then I thought, eunuchos. I looked up instances of the word eunuchos in my a Greek, classical Greek lexicon, you see it used over and over again, and it often means gay man. So I thought, wait a minute, Jesus is indirectly, it can mean that. It can mean somebody who's castrated, but I mean, nobody's born castrated. I mean, so it's very complicated. Alexander the Great was famously in love with Bilbao, who was a eunuchos. So it often stood in for gay man. So in many ways, I say in this CNN piece, it was risky, because it probably is dubious. But I said, let's just at least look at this and say, certainly take the fact that Jesus doesn't talk about gays at all. Second of all, he hedges his bets on divorce. Third, I think the main thing Jesus would have said is, who am I to judge? And I think that Pope Francis, as, you know, interestingly took the name Francis, because Francis throughout the Middle Ages was Alter Christus, right? The second Christ. I think that, so I say, let's just essentially, my position on gay marriage, anything would be, we should not be judging. It's not in our purview to make these kinds of decisions. So, of course, you know, 500 emails come rushing in, mostly from Texas, telling me that it's going to be very hot down where I'm going. Well, listen, let's have some questions. Enough of that. Okay, yes?
Would you say some more about the Vulgate in the translation of St. Jerome? Is that, how much of that is, your translation was a little different?
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, there are massive studies of the Vulgate of St. Jerome.
We have a microphone, too, so...
Okay. The question is, I'll repeat this one, is what about the Vulgate? Well, the Vulgate is the great Latin translation of the Bible. And just a lot of theological notions, such as the idea of repentance, go back to the Jerome translation. One could go through it in great detail, but that, in a nutshell, there's lots of places where modern scholars would say, what was he basing this on? And it's pretty clear, if you follow the lines of mistranslation, that he's basing a lot of his Hebrew on the second century BC translation of the Bible into Greek, right? So that was really what most people were reading. Most Jews read the Bible by the Hebrew scriptures in a Greek translation, second century BC. Okay? Yeah, another question. Yeah.
Is this on?
It's on.
I'm just astonished by the way that your mind works and how it's incredible. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's astonishing. I think I just wanted to acknowledge that. I'm sure every person in this room is thinking that same thought. It's just very inspiring and very gratifying. And I would love it if you would read something from your book. And perhaps a passage that talks to yourself and how you evolved through the writing.
Let me see. I did remember to bring a copy this morning. I almost forgot one. let's just maybe take something here. Here's what I like, okay? Okay. I say, the story of Jesus, here's from my preface, the ending of my preface, which I kind of like. the story of Jesus transcends time and physical boundaries. To understand it, one must remain open to every possibility regarding the miracles of Jesus and the resurrection as mysteries more alluring than frustrating, more inspiring than disconcerting. I narrate the life of Jesus from Bethlehem to Golgotha and beyond, with sympathy for its profound mythic pull, its transforming powers. I stop by the wayside to explain major moments or concepts that may not be familiar to all readers, such as the virgin birth or the transfiguration. In the process of remythologizing Jesus, I take in stride the supernatural aspects of his life, believing that reality is more complex than we usually think, and that we can't begin to imagine the truth of things with the limited intellectual and perceptual machinery we've been given. In this, I follow St. Anselm, who referred to, quote, faith on a quest to know, writing, for I do not seek to understand so that I may believe, but I believe so that I may understand. Within the Christian worldview, history becomes a pattern of timeless moments, and the work involves trying to find a place in the bewildering universe of hints and guesses that confront us as we search, looking around us at things we can scarcely hope to comprehend with the limited intellect and resources we've been given. As T.S. Eliot put it so beautifully in The Dry Salvages, there are only hints and guesses. Hints followed by guesses, and the rest is prayer, observance, discipline, thought, and action.
So, I'm looking forward to reading this.
Oh, good.
Could you comment briefly, please, on the opinions and conclusions you reached as they might differ or agree with Schoenfeld's The Passable Plot, 1966?
I don't know the book.
Okay.
So I can't comment on that. Yes?
I feel a little weird saying
Say something.
Let's wait for the microphone.
No one's as weird as I am.
I've always...
She's got a microphone there. There you go.
So everybody can hear me.
I've seen The Resurrection the way you have talked about it today.
Yeah. Oh, good.
But I got another little seed planted that I'm kind of working over in my mind with a Buddhist who's stationed in Burlington, Shinzen Young.
I know Shinzen.
Yeah. And he was talking, he's the one who's been designing the experiments with the researchers at Harvard with his meditate.
Yeah.
And the researchers were kind of shocked because some of his meditators went into the state that was like death. They couldn't measure anything. And Shinzen said, Eastern meditators can sometimes do that for as long as a week. So I began to think, God, maybe Jesus went into that kind of state, that he knew those kind of ways of meditating and was, you know, really... was there. I mean, it's a weird possibility. I like yours more, but it was sort of an interesting
thing. Well, I never liked those kinds of explanations for what happened because I don't want to go that literal.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I think anytime you go literal with this stuff, you're in the realm of death.
Uh-huh.
Mm. Yes?
Earlier you said for those who have not read the Bible.
For those who have not read the Bible.
Read only Matthew.
Matthew 5, 6, and 7.
5, 6, and 7.
Read that. That's the teachings of Jesus. Yes, here. Here comes a microphone. You can speak into the microphone.
I love that you appreciate the mythos, but you seem to also embrace the faith aspect of Christianity. And I would love to hear how you personally respond to people maybe calling you less of a Christian, which you seem to imply by your letters from Texas.
Yeah.
How do you emotionally respond to that, intellectually respond to that?
Well, I don't worry about it. I did a debate on God about 4 years ago in Pennsylvania with Christopher Hitchens. Yeah. There was a big book festival somewhere in Pennsylvania, and I was invited to do a debate with Hitchens, and I thought I must be out of my mind. And, you know, because he debated all the time, and I don't debate anybody except my wife. So I agreed to do it, and I think I drove him mad because I said, Christopher, I had known him for years, and I said, you know, you're such, I can't stand this literal thinking that you get into. And I said, fundamentalists and atheists are literal thinkers, and they're two sides of the same coin. And I said, so whenever I run into a fundamentalist or an atheist, I say, open your mind, you know, start to understand how metaphor works, and understand how this, let the spirit in. Yeah, that's my view. Simple. So I just think a literal-minded thinking drives me mad, whether it's coming from the Christian right or the new atheist left. It's all the same.
I disagree with you to a certain extent.
Yes. Good. Disagree with me. Most people do.
I do believe in the resurrection, and I'll tell you why.
All right. I do too, but...
Yeah. Well, I believe in a real resurrection, not a mythical resurrection. Because all the apostles and all his followers, they ran. They were scared. Mm-hmm. And I understand why. I would have run myself. But then the gospel says he resurrected from the dead, and he went to the Sea of Galilee, etc. And they saw him. He ate with them, and they talked with them, and then they changed. All of those people were eventually martyred. They were no longer afraid. And what changed them was not a transformation in the mind, but an actual feeling and eating with Jesus.
Yeah.
And that's the only way I could see that Christianity survived. and went forward. And now billions of people believe in Christianity. And I think it was because, and about the crucifixion, it says in the book that the he died on the cross and that a centurion put a spear in his heart. And out of his heart came a side, near his heart, I suppose, blood and then water. Mm-hmm. So he was completely, there's no question that he was dead, that, and that he was put in the tomb. But he came out of the tomb, and that's the thing about Christianity. If he didn't come out of the tomb, then it's all a ruse, and it isn't worth following.
See, I don't agree with that, but yeah. Obviously. I think that you know, one needs to give some credence to the literal heft of this, and it's very possible that Jesus was literally resurrected. Oddly enough, I don't care. I care more about the mythic dimension, which I think is what affects us personally. And I think that it's that internal transformation that we encounter through the story. And all we're encountering is the story. And our own, I mean, I do a daily meditation prayer sequence. And through that, every day, I feel like I'm coming into contact with God. I, you know, had a piece, supposed to be out today, but I think it's coming out tomorrow on the Daily Beast, talking about Islam. And I was talk about how recently I was in Cairo, and I sat next to an old Islamic businessman at this dinner party, and he was talking about how five times a day he joined his whole group in prayer. And he said, it's so wonderful to be, and no, five times a day you'll be in the presence of God. And I thought, wow, if I weren't myself, I'd consider myself a devout Christian, I'd be there with him. Because I think to be in the presence of God as much as possible, or whatever one means by God, is tremendously refreshing. And that's how we are in touch with eternal life, through the endless refreshment with the Spirit. So it's a different concept.
And that's why we have the Eucharist.
Well, the Eucharist is exactly that. I agree with you. Yes, question here. Could we bring that over there? Okay. We only have another 5 minutes, so yeah. I know you've got another program after this.
It's been such a delight to hear you this morning and again this afternoon.
Speak loudly.
I was wondering about the evidence that has claimed to be showing that Christ had been to Hemus Monastery in Ladakh and also to Srinagar.
I do mention a little bit that there's a lot of stories about how Christ may have traveled far. It seems unlikely because, you know, when even the Gospels are going to say he went to the farthest ends of the earth, Syria, and so forth. So really, it's extremely unlikely that I can't see it physically that Jesus would have gone to India, or as you know, many people thought that he went to England, right? And did those feet in ancient lands, you know, Blake writes a poem about it. So people, there were lots of myths of maybe some reincarnation of Jesus appeared in those places. And I do think that Jesus has an awful lot in common with the Buddha. I think that, you know, the whole idea of bodhisattva is crucial for Christian thinking. There's a wonderful book that without the Buddha, I couldn't be a Christian. And I think that the more one knows about all religious traditions, the more all of our faiths will be amplified and our understandings deepened and widened. Yes, sir.
I have a question that builds on that. I was really fascinated with your comments about karma, mm-hmm. and it gets at something that I've been curious about, because mm-hmm. it seems like often Jesus' teachings are interpreted as, if you do this, this will happen to you, and that's seen as a punishing God who simply makes something happen in an arbitrary sort of way, whereas karma is a way of saying, this is the way life is, and the actions that you take will have a certain
reaction.
So I guess I have a two-part question.
Well, read the Beatitudes carefully.
Yeah.
It's a perfect restatement of Buddhist philosophy of karma.
So I guess my two-part question is to follow up on that first question. Where do you think Jesus, or how did he come to this?
Well, like I said, he was on the Silk Road, and so you had so many merchants coming through from Persia. And so I think a lot of the stories that are made it into the Gospels are Persian stories. The birth, the virgin birth idea, all the birth ideas of Jesus are Persian stories. And I think that there was a lot of language even coming in to Palestine on that Silk Road that was coming in from India and China. So I don't think there was, I see, that's how I see that as being transmitted. Jesus was able to pick up these ideas.
Hmm? So he was picking things up from Hinduism, from Buddhism.
I think so.
Yeah. And I guess then the other part of that question is more metaphorically.
Metaphorically.
How you'd see this whole internalization of the process of karma as a larger theme in Jesus' teaching.
Well, first of all of Jesus' teachings are about karma. The way we behave in the world is the way we will create the world. Okay? Jesus talks about doing good works because that is creating community, and that is extending the Spirit of God as it's manifest in us to those around us. We become the body of Christ in the world is the idea. And I think that this is a fundamental idea of all Christian faith. That one does extend oneself to other people. I mean, Jesus, look at how Jesus spoke to the marginalized, always. You know, the prostitute he meets at the well, crippled people, lepers. There was tax collectors, for God's sake. He'll talk to anybody. If you'll talk to a tax collector, he'll talk to anybody. And I think Jesus was preaching again and again, do not judge. This is not your business in the world to judge. Your business is to be present in the lives of those around you and to create community and to help as you can. That is the message of Jesus. And also the message being that if you do this and you model this, you will personally be transformed. Eternity will be yours because you'll discover that eternal life is now and it will stay with you. And then, you know, you don't worry about the morrow. You don't worry about the fact that life, the flesh fades because the spirit stays. You know, I think that's the... And that is essentially the teachings of the Buddha, and it's in its own different language. Jesus has his own vernacular, and I think many of the same ideas are put into that vernacular, the Christian vernacular, embodied in the Eucharist. Okay, well, one more question right here, and then we'll call it a day.
Hi. I'm just wondering, how did this ever... teachings of peace and non-judging, how did it ever transmit or change to you know, the anti-Semitism that Pope Francis and other popes have over time now been disputing and saying that, you know, it wasn't the Jews' fault that they didn't kill Jesus, and on and on and on, every facet of it?
Well, that's a big question. You're asking essentially how did anti-Semitism come out of Christianity?
Yeah. Especially with his message of peace and non-judgment and karma.
Well, certainly Jesus was not anti-Semitic. Jesus was himself a devout Jew, and everybody in the Jesus circle was a devout Jew. Jesus, you know, they worshipped in the temple. Jesus was totally... a lot of the frankly, I hate to say it, but I will say it. I think that a lot of the anti-Semitic stuff that we have seen in the 20th century can be traced back to Martin Luther, who in the middle of his career wrote an 80-page tract called On the Evil of the Jews. And this served as a blueprint for the Nazis and the Holocaust. So I think that that's an awful truth, but that is something I firmly believe. And there's no doubt that there... there's a lot of confusion that arises from the letters of Paul. Paul was a Pharisee, right? He was a strong Jew, but he said, okay, you guys got it wrong. And he's preaching, especially once he goes beyond certain periphery of near Jerusalem, he's preaching to Greeks, as he calls them, non-Jews, right? And so the arguments about whether or not one should be circumcised or not permeate the epistles of Paul. And so there's lots of questions here. Issues that look to us a little bit like anti-Semitism is simply squabbling among different groups of Jews as to what's the best way to be a Jew. What do you actually have to do to be a Jew? Do you have to be circumcised? Can you eat meat if it's not been slaughtered in a certain way? Do you have to have a ritual bath before you have sex? All kinds of things along these lines. And so a lot of the stuff that looks to us like anti-Semitism in the Bible sometimes is simply squabbling among different sects within Judaism itself, which is a religion of many, many strains, right? Okay, well, I'm afraid I have to stop there. I wish I could go into that. Thank you.